We're joined by Paul Azinger, who will join us on the broadcast. These are my favorite interviews. I have no notes. I have no plan.
Me neither.
We just get to talk here for about 10 minutes. It's good, right? I just want to make sure we're on an even playing field for once. So that that works out pretty well. What's your excitement level for seeing this, Paul, for seeing these guys, this format, and a return to live golf for the first time in 9 weeks?
Well, that's my biggest excitement, the live golf part and the fact that we all get to see Seminole. I've played it many, many times, and I know what Seminole is all about. It's going to be a fun course for the viewer. I think a lot of the people that love the game of golf know all about Seminole, may never get to play it, Mike. But it's a fascinating golf course. It's right on the ocean. The ball scurries along on the ground. It scampers all over the place, and there are just devilish bunkers that sit below the greens, and they really eat the ball up if you don't hit a quality shot into the greens. It's a great driving course. It's a simple driving course. We're going to see some bombs by those four players, but it's a real demanding second shot course. Hogan and Jimmy DeMeritt and Claude Harmon, Butch's dad, would go to Seminole to prepare for the Masters because it has that kind of shot quality to it. Crazy. It was built in 1930 by Donald Ross. There's been a few slight restorations done to it, Mike, but I think the reason it's going to be so great to watch is because of just the whole historical nature of the golf course and the fact that it's one of the best golf courses on the planet. It should be fun.
Routinely top 15 in the world, never seen in a live broadcast, so we're excited about that aspect of it, the charity aspect as well, and also seeing these teams of PGA Tour pros. I'm going to work in reverse order here for a second, and I'm going to start with Matthew Wolff, who at 21 already has a tour win, has an NCAA championship under his belt. A lot of the general sports fans, not our hardcore golf fans, may not have heard much about him. What would you tell folks about Matthew?
Well, you know, yesterday we had our media kind of conference over the phone there, and, you know, I think Matt Wolff was, I think it hit them all yesterday, really, that this was going to be a big, big deal, Mike. And I know it hit Matt Wolff because some people were asking him, why are you even in it? There were people questioning why he would be in this thing. And that's got to be some added pressure for him and a little bit of burden of proof for Matt Wolff. But I heard Crenshaw the other day describe his forward press is like a slingshot. And that is kind of what it's like. It's like this motion, like whack, whack. He has a big kickstart. He won NCAAs and then came back and won, as you said, right on the PGA Tour, like his fourth ever tournament on the tour. He's got all kinds of potential, but a very unique swing, big time across the line at the top, and just the opposite of Ricky Fowler, who's big time laid off at the top. I mean, their clubs are probably pointing at the top of their backswings, maybe 60 yards apart.
That's a pretty good point. That's a pretty good visual with their two swings. During your career, Paul, you know, you kind of make the jump, whether it's a Ryder Cup team or you become a PGA champion. You start to find yourself with the best in the sport. And you all of a sudden look around and you go, man, I'm with these guys. What is that feeling like when that happens to you as an individual?
Interesting that you would ask me that, because for some reason this morning I was thinking about my first ever PGA Tour event at the Phoenix Open and the feeling that I had on the putting green seeing Trevino and Weisskopf and Nicklaus and Watson and Raymond Floyd. They were all there, and it was intimidating, I tell you. It was really intimidating. I didn't think I belonged there. But, you know, I lost my card and had been through a few years of heartache with respect to golf. And eventually your self-belief gets to a point that matches your confidence. And, you know, it's hard to hold a guy back. These four players that are going to play in this thing on Sunday are going to be four of the most confident players on the planet, even though they haven't played in weeks and weeks. Dustin Johnson and Rory haven't played at all. Ricky and Wolf have been playing quite a bit, and actually Ricky and Rory know the course like the back of their hand, so a good thing they split those two up, or it would have been a whitewash. I think it's going to be a good match, and it might come down to just what Rory and Ricky can do, because it takes local knowledge to play that course. But these guys are confident. They're going to strike the ball well. They're going to hit a lot of good quality shots. And then, of course, Seminole says, I dare you to attack me, because if you do, you're probably going to pay a price. So we'll see with this format. They just want to make birdies, you know, how they're going to go about it. But their self-belief reached an all-time level, Mike, and that's the reason that they've been selected to come and do this and try to raise money for a great cause.
Yeah, and with Matthew Wolf, even though he doesn't have the pedigree, the length of time out there, the confidence of winning as a rookie, winning the NCAA, which is hard because college golf has become really, really deep and good. And on top of that, he's got a friendship with Ricky Fowler, both Oklahoma State. So there's a little bit, if it can be a comfort zone for him, being with these guys who have accomplished so much more. Let me go to the guy who's accomplished the most in terms of majors and is currently number one, and that's Rory McIlroy. It felt, Zinger, like Rory was in position to have one of those kind of years. How much of a challenge is it going to be for him to kind of put those pieces back together over the next few months to be in position for that run a little bit later in the season when we start to get to the tour playoffs and the majors as well?
Yeah, the hardest thing about golf is picking up where you left off when you have a bit of a break. You know, Tiger's probably the best at that, I think. You know, he could take a week off and then come back out and play good. He could take a month off and play well. He could win back-to-back weeks and then win again. It's just a remarkable feat. But Rory's got a mindset. I felt like last year at the Open Championship in Ireland that he kind of underplayed the value and importance, and it backfired on him. He was more nervous, and it meant more to him than he was willing to admit. And now it seems like Rory wants to admit that he's nervous, admit what these events are meaning to him. And I think it's a positive for Rory McIlroy and his mindset. He's a beautiful player, Mike. If you stand there and listen to the ball come off of his irons with his wedges, it's a sight to behold. He's become a clutch putter thanks to Brad Faxon. And he drives it as well as anybody on the planet. It's a great combination. He's going to hit a lot of wedges at this golf course at Seminole. And he may be able to make a lot of birdies, but Rory's a world-class champion. He's a great guy, and it's hard not to root for Rory McIlroy. But he feels pressure like maybe I did or somebody that doesn't achieve quite the way he has. He's, you know, I always say sometimes it's what you overcome that matters. And for Rory, he overcomes pressure every time he wins. Right. And a guy like Tiger seemed like he had a complete handle on it. It doesn't bother Brooks, but it affects Rory, and that's why – when he does win, it means so much to him.
A lot of us who golf have played skins, but these skins games, and you've been a part of them. What is it like for tour players at that level playing for that kind of money in a skins format?
Well, the pressure is always on the putter. It comes down to the putter, and you got Ricky Fowler, maybe the best putter ever. I mean, best putter on tour now, best looking, flowing, fluid, smooth looking stroke. I mean, he hits no doubters, doesn't he, Ricky Fowler? And Faxon's been working with Rory quite a bit, and he's starting to look a little bit like Ricky to me in his rhythm and the way he approaches his putts. But skins games always comes down to the putt, and those are some of the tricky screens in the world to putt on. Rory and Ricky are putting the best of the four of them, and they know the greens the best. So I think they'll be the two guys that will end up being the most clutch. It's just what I think.